It was a shot that rang around the world. The assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand and his wife on the 28th of June 1914 was to provide the spark that would eventually lead to the raging inferno of the Great War. In Britain, eager, patriotic young men enlisted in their thousands to fight for king and country. None of these innocent men could have imagined the horrors that beckoned. For before them lay not honor or glory, but a sheer hell on earth. The nightmare of life in the trenches. It was supposed to be a mobile war. A war of movement, of thrust and counter-thrust, of powerful, decisive attacks. It was to be an opportunity to deploy the new weapons and tactics of modern combat. How noble was the aim? How different was the reality? During the early weeks of the Great War, both sides had formulated strategies intended to deliver swift victory. The German Schlieffen Plan, whereby they would outflank the French army by invading Belgium, was part of the famous Race for the Sea. For their part, the French, allied with the British, had placed their faith in Plan 17, a massive offensive along the German frontier. Unfortunately, the high commands of both sides possessed an ill-judged faith in the offensive skills of their own troops and an unhealthy disrespect for the fighting qualities of their opponents. What was more, battle tactics were still steeped in the traditions of the Franco-Prussian War and the American Civil War. Strategies had not been devised to complement the new weapons, such as the machine gun. Before very long, the grand design of the German and Allied armies had been shattered, as their attacks stuttered, foundered, and ground to a halt. Soon, visions of quick victory were gone, and ambitions had to be adjusted to holding on to the territory already won, of merely stopping the counterattacks of the other side. To achieve this, large, deep rifle pits were dug in the ground, into which men clambered to consolidate their positions. Eventually, the holes grew bigger and longer and deeper still, until they had turned into enormous ditches. Still the earth was turned, the sandbags and barbed wire appeared, and by October 1914, the trenches of the Western Front were fully formed, ready to leave their scars on history. The Western Front stretched out in a jagged line from the North Sea to the Swiss border in the south, a distance of some 475 miles. The Germans had quickly realized that if the war were to become a battle of attrition, it would be to their advantage. After all, the onus was on the Allies to expel them, for they had already struck deep into the heart of French and Belgian territory. The German trenches, therefore, were constructed with defense as their prime consideration, and the strength of their fortification suggested a grim air of permanency. Quite unable to break through these lines, the Allies soon decided to follow suit, and they too dug deep to establish permanent positions. From the very start, however, the Allies were at a disadvantage. Having decided to dig their trenches first, the Germans had generally afforded themselves the pick of the ground. In many cases, the Allies were left to dig in the very worst terrain, such as the lowland marshes of Picardy, which meant that the unfortunate inhabitants of the newly constructed trenches had to live in the most miserable wet conditions. And of course, the Germans had won for themselves the enormous tactical advantage of occupation of the higher ground. Allied attacks, therefore, would have to be made mostly uphill, making success doubly difficult. And so, the mobile war had turned into the exact opposite, a static, attritional slugging match. The two sides like punch-drunk boxers, toe-to-toe, unwilling to give an inch. The time and the place had been chosen. The scene was set. And the men of all armies were plunged into the grim reality of war in the trenches. The typical British trench, seen here in side view, was usually 7 or 8 feet deep and 6 to 7 feet wide. Thick walls of sandbags provided protection from shell fragments or bullets, and in the walls of the trench were dugouts where a man would sleep or shelter from the elements. British High Command actually discouraged the construction of comfortable living quarters. And these dugouts were often cramped and wet, and hardly conducive to affording the rest the soldiers so desperately needed. The British frontline trench was never built in a straight line. This diagram illustrates the system of fire bays and traverses, which were designed to protect the men against bursting shells and enfilading or machine gun fire. Running out towards the opposing lines was a sap, a precarious vantage point for nervous sentries to oversee or overhear activities in the enemy positions or the approach of an enemy raiding party. To the rear of the main firing line were the support and reserve trenches, which completed the frontline system. The area between the two armies, called No Man's Land, varied in size from half a mile to only a few yards, depending on the lie of the ground. The positions of both were defended by thick belts of barbed wire.
It's not always realised that the British sent 4 different types of armies to fight in Flanders between 1914 and 1918. The first, of course, was the old BEF, British Expeditionary Force, probably the most professional army we've ever sent abroad. They, of course, were mostly dead by the early months of 1915, something like 70% casualties by that time. So the next army that came out to France was the Territorial Force, as they then called the Territorial Army, which were all, again, peacetime soldiers who had done weekend soldiering and so forth, just as the TA does now. And they were very good in their turn, but by the end of 1915, I'm afraid they too had gone in large number. And so when we turn at last to Kitchener's army, we've come to the third, and probably the most dramatic of all the armies we sent to France and Flanders that particular war. Now, of course, they were volunteers. These were mostly people who had volunteered in 1914, wishing to get into the war before it was all over by Christmas, was the famous phrase at the time. They'd been having 2.5 years being trained, and were at the peak of physical fitness, but of course had no experience of the reality of battle whatsoever, except that which you could get on exercises or battle schools or the notorious Bull Ring up by Calais, where they were given their battle inoculation training. In their turn, the volunteer armies would have something like 600,000 casualties before the end of the year. So yet again, we had to produce the fourth type of army, and this was the conscript army. For the very first time in British history, we began to compulsorily conscript manpower for the armed forces. And that began in the autumn of 1916, and they will be the people who fought through 1917 and above all in 1918.
The first few weeks of the war had seen men enlist in their thousands, seized by the popular mood of fervent patriotism. These would be the men of the Citizens' Army, the first in British history. Posters, such as the famous example featuring Lord Kitchener, appeared on post boxes and in shop windows. "Your king and country need you," they insisted. And there was no shortage of enthusiastic young men ready to answer the call. They came in all shapes and sizes, from a variety of backgrounds, and from north, south, east, and west. Many, of course, were still only boys, and their enthusiasm to join the ranks was understandably not always shared by their worried parents.
I never said anything about enlisting when I went home that night. But on the Sunday morning, there was an OHMS envelope. So when breakfast started, Mother said, "What's that? Get it opened." I didn't want to open it. She insisted. Instructions were to report to Drill Hall in Edmund Road in Sheffield. When I read that out, "Jack," she said to Dad, "stop his gallop. He doesn't go." So Dad said, "Have you joined Pete?" I said, "Yes, Dad." "Well," I said, "this is a nice how do you do." Then Mother began to get excited. She said, "Stop his gallop, Dad." So Dad said, "Well, just supposing, Pete, you came back with a leg or an arm off. But you don't know what you've done." I said, "But I do know what I've done." "All right," he said. "If you've made your bed, you'll have to lie in it." I said, "I'll lie in it, Dad." "Well," he said to Mother, "there's no more to be said, Mum." That was the start.
A major problem for the frontline troops was the sheer tedium of trench life, the dullness and difficulty of which was enough to wear down the hardiest of souls. Days were spent in an attempt to rest, while nights involved patrols, or digging latrines, or repairing trenches, or carrying up rations and other supplies. For most, this uncomfortable, wearying routine was broken only sporadically by action. Men new to the Western Front soon got used to the interminable daily grind. There was a stand to at dawn and a stand to at dusk. This involved standing on the fire step of the trench for 1 hour in preparation for an enemy attack which hardly ever came. This may have been because the Germans were carrying out the exact same exercise only a few hundred yards away, at the exact same time. The dawn stand to was followed by an hour of peaceful silence, during which both sides prepared, ate, and digested their breakfasts. The stand to at dusk was often brought to an end by an officer's inspection, after which the night's fatigue duties would be allocated. And so the grinding routine went on. Day after day, night after night. To add to his burdens, the British soldier marching to the front line had also to contend with the weight of his kit, the average of which was about 60 pounds. The averagely built private was therefore obliged to carry half his own weight again in equipment and personal belongings. And this in often tiring, strength-sapping conditions. What was more, his less than top quality boots also weighed more than 5 pounds each. And pity the man whose boots did not fit, for he was condemned to a torturous life, blighted by painful feet. At the beginning of the war, the men of both sides were equipped with soft headwear, the smart but not very protective peaked cap. The introduction of the helmet to the British ranks did not come until 1916, but its belated appearance certainly heralded a dramatic reduction in head wounds. However, the price of this additional safety was an extra £2 for the overburdened Tommy to carry.
Sustaining the huge army on the Western Front presented even more problems. Whilst actively at the front, the men rarely, if ever, received a hot meal, their staple diet being bread, bully beef, and biscuits. Drinking water, too, was in short supply. In the worst recorded cases, men were desperate enough to boil water drawn from the bottom of a shell hole.
One soldier remembers.
In my whole 4 years as a squaddy, I was hungry all the time. It must have taught me a lesson, though, for never in the rest of my life did I grumble about a poor meal. Behind the lines, you could buy, if you had the money, bread or eggs or sweets. You could sometimes have a meal in the back room of a shop. Our actual rations were about half what they should have been. I reckon that enough food to satisfy every soldier left the base, but the nearer it got to the battle area, the more it got sold or stolen. If anyone had asked the powers that be, they'd have said that every soldier got half a loaf a day. Do me a favour. We never got there once, did we? Loads of times I only had one slice of breakfast with hard biscuits for tea. I'll tell you, those biscuits were so hard that you had to put them on a firm surface and smash them with a stone or something. I've held one in my hand and hit it with a sharp corner of brick wall and only hurt me bloody hand. Sometimes we soaked the bits in water for days. Then we'd eat and drain them, pour condensed milk over a dish full of the stuff and get it down. It felt like a half brick, but at least your stomach was full. What are you looking at?
To fight the war on a full stomach, it was advisable to serve as an officer, for they certainly enjoyed better quality food. Mealtimes would often feature such delights as fish, vegetables, cheese, and chocolate. And many officers came from the kind of privileged background which allowed delicious hampers to be delivered to the front from London's top department stores such as Fortnum and Mason. What cannot be overstated is the appalling natural hardships which blighted the troops, whose living conditions were quite often intolerable. There was, for example, an almost constant battle, particularly in low-lying areas, against water and mud. It was only the arrival of summer which brought the troops some relief. Otherwise, each rainfall meant the same misery. Trenches ankle deep, often higher in mud. Some men actually drowned in the mud, and tales of men slipping into shell holes, gradually sinking, watched by horrified and helpless comrades, are well documented. These terrible conditions also heralded the appearance of trench foot, a condition similar to frostbite, which was caused by constant immersion in water. During the war, over 74,000 British troops were treated in France for trench foot. The filth of the trenches inevitably produced a host of diseases, and the men's unwashed condition brought the problem of lice, which tormented most soldiers.
My pal, who did night sentry with me, he was called Jock. He was a big, strapping man. A fine lad he was. One night, as we lay in our bed after doing 2 hours sentry duty, we did 2 hours on and 2 hours off. He was scratching in bed as if he would tear himself to bits. Then all at once he says, "Damn this, Gregor, I can't stand it any longer." He took off his tunic, which he slept in. Then he took off his jersey, then his shirt. He put his shirt in the middle of the dugout flare, and then he put his jersey and his tunic on again. And as we both sat up in our beds watching the shirt, it actually lifted. It was swarming with lice. "Did you see it move, Gregory?" he asked. And I said, "Aye, I had." After this, he took it to a field and buried it in the ground. Then he got some rest for a wee while, and some sleep as well.
But if these horrors were not enough, without doubt the most unpleasant problem encountered by the British soldier was the rat, which grew to incredible size, bloated by gorging on the many half-buried corpses which littered the area around the trenches. Men would be woken by rats scurrying over their faces as they searched for food in their dugouts. A French soldier told one horrifying story. One evening, whilst on patrol, Jacques saw some rats running from under the dead men's greatcoats. Enormous rats, fat with human flesh. His heart pounding, he edged towards one of the bodies. Its helmet had rolled off. The man displayed a grimacing face, stripped of flesh, the skull bare, the eyes devoured. The rats coexisted with the men in the trenches. All efforts to rid themselves of their unwanted neighbors ended in failure, and the rats swarmed around in their millions throughout the war. A British officer remembered life in the vermin-infested trenches.
"The outstanding feature of the Armentières sector was the extraordinary number of rats. The area was infested with them. It was impossible to keep them out of the dugouts even. They grew fat on the food that they pilfered from us and anything they could pick up in or around the trenches. They were bloated and loathsome to look at. We were filled with an instinctive hatred of them because, however one tried to put the thought out of one's mind, one could not help feeling that they fed on the dead. We waged an endless war on them, and they were very easy prey because they were so fat and slow of foot. We would wait and watch for them to leave the water and climb awkwardly onto the boards at the bottom of the trench. Then, with a run, we would catch them squarely with a mighty kick, and that would be one less to bother us. On one occasion, a blasted rat ran right across my face while I was sleeping. Unfortunately, my mouth happened to be open, and the hind legs of the filthy little beast went right in. Ugh.
All of these things contributed to the miserable life of the British Tommy on the Western Front during the war. Not only was he in danger from rifle or machine gun fire or shelling from the enemy artillery or the bullets from snipers, but he had to live with the daily risk of disease, infection, and illness. British statistics tell the awful tale. During the Great War, there were more than 2.5 million casualties in battle, whilst 3.5 million were victims of sickness or disease. It is little wonder that the men thrown together into such terrible conditions soon developed a deep sense of comradeship. Great friendships were forged by the most unlikely of men, those from different upbringing, backgrounds, and cultures. Once formed, however, these attachments were bonded by their unique hardships and privations, and by the knowledge that in a split second, a comrade could be lost, and a friendship could be ended forever. One soldier noted in his diary, "To live amongst men would give their last fag, their last bite, aye, even their last breath for a pal. That's comradeship, the comradeship of the trenches. It is the only clean thing born of this life of cruelty and filth. It grows in purity from the very obscenity of its surroundings." Another soldier wrote touchingly of the pain of seeing his friends die in battle. His words display a dreadful bewilderment and a pathetic, sad acceptance of his own likely fate. Why, he wrote, had his greatest friends been taken? But meantime, Dennis, Henry, and all the others are happy together. They're waiting for me to join them. When I do, they'll give me a great welcome. Then I'll understand everything, be happy and content. Nothing can recall the past, so no use worrying or being unhappy about it. I feel I've lost interest in everything. As his chief weapon, the British infantryman carried the .303 Lee Enfield rifle, fairly accurate up to 1,000 yards. With its long bayonet for hand-to-hand combat. The infantry were also supported by heavy machine guns, which took 6 men to operate and carry its ammunition supply. But it was a murderous weapon when in full flow, firing some 600 rounds per minute. In this most static of wars, however, the combatants were, for the majority of time, hidden from each other's view. So hand-to-hand combat was rare, and it was the artillery which was dominant. The frontline soldier never knew when or where the next shell would fall. He lived in dread of instant death or terrible injury. The noise and terror of an artillery bombardment can only be imagined. The threatening prospect of sudden bombardments at any time, day or night, and the effect of the shells when they did burst, led to many cases of shell shock, a physical and mental trauma caused by exposure to constant shelling. Unfortunately, Many commanders, particularly generals, believed shell shock to be little more than an excuse for cowardice. One type of shell which was feared perhaps above all others was that which contained gas. This dreadful weapon was used by both sides after the first gas attack at the Second Battle of Ypres in 1915. There were three types of gas: chlorine, phosgene, and mustard. All caused the most appalling pain and suffering. Chlorine, for example, caused death by asphyxiation, although this took some 4 or 5 days, during which the victim was in constant agony. Mustard gas, on the other hand, simply caused the body to rot with nausea and vomiting, skin blistering, and the most excruciating pain in the lungs. In these cases, sufferers took as long as a month to expire. One horrified nurse who witnessed the effects of gas remembered only too well.
I wish those people who talk so glibly about this being a holy war and going on no matter how long it takes could see a case of mustard gas in its early stages. Poor chaps, burnt and blistered all over, with blind eyes, fighting for breath, saying their throats are closing and they know they'll choke. Makes you feel like weeping.
For many soldiers, the war meant separation from their loved ones for the very first time. One can imagine the joy then with which letters and parcels from home were received. These simple communications, read and reread, provided great comfort to a fed-up, frightened soldier. Writing letters to home was not something that came easily to a good many frontline troops. Few had ever had to write to their wives or mothers before, and not surprisingly, they struggled to express their feelings. What was more, letters were censored by officers, which placed a further restriction upon what could be said in a letter.
Just a few loving lines in answer to your kind and loving letter, and thanking you for the two beautiful parcels, which has come in very handy. The cake was quite unbroken, and me and my mates enjoyed it very much in the trenches. Dear Mrs., we have been 6 days and 6 nights under fire, but the Germans will never advance near because they're afraid of our rifle fire. We are back now for a bit of a rest, and we can do with it too, but every night we dig trenches under fire. We shall go into the trenches again soon, and after that we come home on leave, so I shall see you and the two dear babies again. Oh, what joyful times we shall have when all this is over. We are fed up, but we keep on smiling. Dear Mrs., I will close now, for the censor won't let us say anything. Hoping you were in the pink, as this letter leaves me. Your loving, Bert.
To the modern observer, one of the grimmest fascinations of the Great War is the apparent futility of the battle tactics used by both sides. Although it is easy to be wise with the gift of hindsight, it does appear that bloody and costly lessons were not absorbed by the high commands of both the Allied and German armies. Indeed, the same failed strategies were often used again and again. which succeeded in achieving only one thing, an increase in the appalling casualty figures. It may have been that the static nature of the war presented the generals with few viable options. Perhaps a further contribution to the misery was the absence of new ideas and initiatives, and the reliance on the battle tactics of times past. At this distance, for example, it is staggering to learn that on the first day of the Battle of the Somme, a British cavalry division waited patiently behind the lines to make their attack. And this in the battle which saw the first use of the tank. What was more, Sir Douglas Haig, who was commander-in-chief of the British Army at the time, remained convinced of their role in future wars. In 1926, he wrote that aeroplanes and tanks are only accessories to the man and the horse, and I feel sure that as time goes on, you will find as much use for cavalry as ever before. Whatever their motivations, the generals and field marshals decided to make full use of their most reliable and seemingly inexhaustible resource, the ordinary soldier. It is surely beyond the wit of most people to comprehend the feeling of going over the top. To be in a frontline trench, heart pounding, waiting for the officer's whistle to blow, the sign that it was time to face the enemy guns. There were those, particularly very young men, confronted at last with the prospect of a real battle, who were simply overcome with fear. An officer remembered his experience before the Battle of Passchendaele.
An NCO came up and said that Private Jones wished to speak to me. The man was a mere boy whom I had known in England. I felt flattered that he should apply to me for whatever help I could give. I found him crouched against a chalk heap, almost in tears. Looked younger than ever. I don't want to go over the top, he said shamelessly. I'm only 17. I want to go home. The other men standing around avoided my eye and looked more sympathetic than disgusted. I can't help that now, my lad, said I in my martinet voice. You should have thought of that when you enlisted. Didn't give your age as 19, then? Yes, sir, but I'm not. I'm only, well, I'm not quite 17, really, sir. Well, it's too late now, I said. You'll have to see it through, and I'll do what I can for you when we come out. I slapped him on the shoulder. You go with the others. You'll be all right when you get started. This is the worst part of it, this waiting. And we're none of us enjoying it. Come along now. Jump to it. And he seemed to take heart again.
Perhaps the most infamous battle of the First World War is the Battle of the Somme. It has become a byword for the waste, horror, and futility of trench warfare. There were, of course, countless other examples. Ypres, Mons, Cambrai, Passchendaele, and Arras, to list but a few. Yet somehow, nothing has echoed down the years in quite the same way as the events of July the 1st, 1916. The soldiers who marched into battle that day were the proud members of Kitchener's army. They were almost entirely volunteers, the Pals and Chums battalions, there to do their duty for the love of king and country. They had completed 2 years training, and now they were going to take part in the big push, the intended massive Allied breakthrough which would bring victory closer and speed the end of the war. The terrible facts are well documented. Firstly, a thunderous 5-day barrage failed to kill the Germans or destroy their positions. And the British troops had been given the fateful order to walk, not run, towards the enemy lines. The Germans, who had been protected from the barrage by their deep dugouts, raced to their positions and set up their machine guns. At 7:30 a.m., the shocking carnage began. As the German machine gunners poured their murderous fire into the oncoming British soldiers. And still, throughout the morning, despite the hellish scenes, the orders came to attack. Wave after wave of men went forward, and wave after wave were mercilessly cut down. By midday, the 16-mile battlefront had become a nightmare of wounded and dying men.
The great majority of the 60,000 casualties of 1st of July 1916 happened in the first 30 minutes of the day. It was hellish, the only word for it. Not only was all the German artillery zeroed down exactly to no man's land, as one might have expected, all machine guns were also firing on fixed lines from the German positions. And in many cases, troops did not even get out of their trenches. There's a famous example of one battalion which lost 2/3 of its strength before it got to the front line in the support trenches coming up as the second wave. So men were falling in literally hundreds in all directions. And yet, of course, they went on. At the walk, remember, not taking any form of cover. The military dictate of the day said that any soldier who took cover would not come out of cover again. He'd go to ground and stay there. And everywhere, the Germans having really a most marvelous target.
The attack had been a complete and utter disaster. By the end of the day, which saw 60,000 British casualties, 20,000 of them dead, the British had made virtually no worthwhile strategic gains. What had been achieved was the destruction of a proud army born of patriotism and innocence, the brightest flower of British youth. They had been 2 years in the making and 2 hours in the destroying. A British officer recalled the awful events at Gommecourt, scene of a disastrous British diversionary attack to the north of the battlefront.
I was shell-shocked, I suppose. At any rate, I wasn't much use. Inclined to cry, if anything. In fact, I couldn't stop it. But it had been a total shambles. The first two companies got across. I was told to take B Company across to support them. We had no idea that the whole attack was a diversion. We thought we were going forward. We had maps and plans of Gommecourt. We knew from information we'd got from local people exactly where every house was. But the trouble was that Gommecourt stuck out in the middle of the line and we didn't attack it directly. We attacked one side of the Chateau Park and the 56th Division attacked on the other. We were supposed to encircle it and link up behind. But what we didn't know was that the Germans had so maneuvered and organized their line that this part which we weren't to attack was really their strong point. And they simply had a clear field of fire on either side and nothing to bother about in front. And the shell fire was absolutely appalling. They were simply pouring shells down. We just couldn't get across. We didn't even get as far as the trench we'd dug. Well, there was no trench left. It was all hammered to blazes. We got just about as far as our old front line. And then it became quite impossible. The company in front of me said, "It's no use, we can't get over." We got orders to turn and try to make our way back to the village. One of my subalterns was newly out. Such a nice chap. He must have had money, and we used to tease him a bit because his Batman was the family butler. Anyway, this young officer jumped out of the trench to try and organize the men, pass the word and get them moving to the communication trench, and he was promptly killed. Just disappeared in an explosion. The whole of the valley was being swept with machine gun fire and hammered with shells. We got the men organized the best we could, those of us who were left. So many gone, and we'd never even got past our own frontline trench. And then we found we couldn't get back. The trenches were indescribable. We were simply treading on the dead. Eventually, my sergeant and I got out on top. We were at the back of the company. I heard a shell coming. I remember thinking, imagine. Just imagine hearing a single shell in the middle of all this din. It burst above my head. The sergeant was blown one way and I was blown the other. He was killed. I don't know how I got back. I simply don't know how I got back. It was murder.
Over half the British soldiers who served on the Western Front received some form of battle wound, which placed immense pressure on the hard-pressed medical services. Wounded men often received no medical help at all, and some lay in no man's land for 2 or 3 days before they were picked up by stretcher bearers. Needless to say, many died agonizing deaths. With only 4 stretcher bearers per company, the task often overwhelmed the men. For the physical effort of carrying a badly wounded man through the clinging mud left orderlies completely exhausted. Despite the terrible nature of many wounds, ordinary soldiers actually believed the hospital to be their best hope of escape from the trenches. So desperate were they to be free of their horrors, they would pray for a wound which would see them invalided out of the army and back to England. The much sought after blighty one. Sadly, many wounds were severe ones.
About dinner time, the enemy shelling really began. We all crouched down in our shell hole, which I soon began to regret, as a single shell in it would have killed a lot of us. One or two of the men were hit. Especially I remember one who was standing with his sleeves rolled up when a shell burst right above us. A bit of steel came down and hit him on the long bone of the forearm. It made a clean cut 3 inches long between the bone, as if his arm had been slit with a knife. You'd never have believed it. It gaped like a freshly cut shoulder of mutton. Now, this was about as cushy as you could get. But it cured me of hoping for a blighty one. And I think the laddie with the wound would surely have agreed with me.
In the early stages of the war, the medical services were completely unprepared for the enormous numbers of casualties. Even simple necessities, such as trestle beds, did not arrive at the front until March 1915. Up until then, the wounded however badly hurt, lay on stretchers on the floor. However, this desperate situation improved steadily throughout the war, aided by the increase in numbers in the medical corps, which swelled from 20,000 in 1914 to nearly 165,000 by 1918. The casualty figures for the other Allied troops were also startling. The French, for example, suffered over 60% casualties, nearly 4 million men. As for their enemy, the Germans lost 1.75 million men killed from their 11 million mobilized troops. However, on the British side, there are examples of the officer class accepting their wounds, albeit relatively slight ones, in typically stoical manner.
LBW, bold Fritz, put my leg in front of a straight one. Apparently I've been pretty lucky. The bullet went right in behind the knee and came out just below the kneecap. Went clean through without touching anything important, which is fortunate as there are some unpleasant parts of your knee to get damaged. Anyhow, it's not painful, it just throbs a little.
From the hardships and misery of the Great War emerged the songs, which are still identified with that conflict to this very day. Some are songs of hope and optimism. Others are a celebration of the human spirit, of man's ability to conquer terrible adversity. These songs were sung by the soldiers of the frontline trenches, and they remain the best known and most poignant songs of war ever written.
Pack up your troubles in your old kit bag and smile, smile, smile. While you've a Lucifer to light your fag, smile, boys, that's the style. What's the use of worrying? It never was worthwhile. So, pack up your troubles in your old kit bag and smile, smile, smile. Never mind if the sergeant steals your rum. Never mind, though he's just a blinking sot. Let him have the bloody lot. If the sergeant steals your rum, never mind, oh, never mind. It's a long way to Tipperary, it's a long way to go. It's a long way to Tipperary, to the sweetest girl I know. Goodbye, Piccadilly, farewell, Leicester Square. It's a long, long way to Tipperary, but my heart's right there. Keep the home fires burning while your hearts are yearning. Boys are far away, they dream of home. There's a silver lining through the dark clouds shining. Turn the dark clouds inside out till the boys come home.
The horror of the Western Front gave birth to a generation of poets. Their stark, unforgettable verse allows us to understand, if only in part, something of the suffering of the men of the trenches. The bleak words of these young men, in many cases themselves later victims of the war, burnt deep into the nation's conscience. Never again would war be considered a glorious pursuit. The reality was now painfully exposed for all to see. The three poems which follow are powerful examples of the genre. The first, In Flanders Field, by John McCrae, reminds us that despite their privations, soldiers still believed passionately in the cause for which they were fighting. The second, Break of Day in the Trenches, by Isaac Rosenberg, was inspired by a rat which ran across his hand one morning in the trenches. In Flanders fields the poppies blow between the crosses, row on row, that mark our place. And in the sky, the lark still bravely singing, fly scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you, from failing hands, we throw the torch. Be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields. The darkness crumbles away. It's the same old druid time as ever, only a life thing leaps my hand, a queer, sardonic rat, as I pull the parapet's poppy to stick behind my ear. Droll rat. They would shoot you if they knew your cosmopolitan sympathies. Now you have touched this English hand, you will do the same to a German soon, no doubt, if it be your pleasure to cross the sleeping green between. It seems you inwardly grin as you pass strong eyes, fine limbs, haughty athletes, less chance than you for life, bonds to the whim of murder sprawled in the bowels of the earth, the torn fields of France. What do you see in our eyes? At the shrieking iron and flame hurled through the still heavens, what quaver, what heart aghast? Poppies whose roots are in man's veins drop and are ever dropping, but mine in my ear is safe, just a little white with the dust. The last poem, Dulce et Decorum Est, by Wilfred Owen, is read by Brian Blessed. Brian's magnificent reading of this epic work conveys perfectly Owen's hatred of the war. The mood of the poem contrasts sharply with his earlier work, which reflected the popular enthusiasm for the conflict. Clearly, the years spent in the filth of the trenches changed Owen's view. The Latin lines, Dulce et decorum est pro patria mori, which close the poem, can be translated as, it is sweet and right to die for your country. Here, Wilfred Owen buries that old lie forever.
Gas! Gas! Quick, boys! An ecstasy of fumbling, fitting the clumsy helmets just in time. But someone still was yelling out and stumbling and floundering like a man in fire or lime. Dim through the misty panes and thick green light, as under a green sea, I saw him drowning. In all my dreams, before my helpless sight, he plunges at me, guttering, choking. Drowning. If in some smothering dreams you too could pace behind the wagon that we flung him in and watch the white eyes writhing in his face, his hanging face, like a devil's, sick of sin. If you could hear at every jolt the blood come gargling from the froth corrupted lungs, obscene as cancer, bitter as the cud, a vile, incurable sores on innocent tongues? My friend, you would not tell with such high zest to children ardent for some desperate glory the old lie. Dulce et decorum est pro patria mori.
It was, as we all remember, supposed to be the war to end all wars. It all happened again, of course, but surely never in the same terrible way. As an experience of human suffering within warfare, the Great War has no equal. On November 11th, 1918, when the armistice was finally signed, the world stopped, drew breath, and counted the cost of 4 years of war. 8.5 million lives lost. 21 million soldiers wounded. The young men of an entire generation had all but gone. It was left to those who had been there and had lived through the hell to tell of life in the trenches.
I can never express what I feel about the men in the trenches. And nobody who hasn't seen them can ever understand. You may ask one of them, day or night, are you cold or are you wet? And you'll always get the same answer, always with a smile. Not too cold, sir. Or not too wet, sir. It makes me